out again, and loads of fucking money. what's the next one?
MI6,
right. MI6 was the name, still is the name, to the British Secret Service, the secret division of the Foreign Office, okay? And in the late 60s, early 70s, it didn't officially exist. Its most official existence was in James Bond films, because that's what we worked for, okay? And a friend of mine happened to get, a friend of mine at Oxford, a fellow undergraduate, happened to get recruited for the British Secret Service. He didn't tell anyone, I didn't know at the time, but he was quite a close mate. And years later, about 3 or 4 years later, he came along and asked me, you know, would I become an agent for MI6? Fucking hell.
Can you imagine that kind of James Bond?
See, they don't understand. I didn't want a license to kill. I wanted a license to deal for me.
John was a man's best friend.
So, of course, it took me a while to realise after a few things happened that the reason they actually wanted me to join is they knew I had friends in the IRA. Like, suddenly they started becoming a thorn in the side. And my recruiter, this was only after about 9 months actually, my recruiter said, look, we know you're seeing the IRA, right? We know you're bringing in dope with them, can you help us catch them, right? So I said, yes, obviously, right now call them if they want you guys. And then I got the sack.
Did you get your Aston Martin first?
No, we got anything, it's only about 9 months. But you know, there's a like prevalent belief that once you're working for the Secret Service, you're always working for them for life. But like once you're in that fucking club, that's it, you're there till you die. So I kept saying, well, I'm still working for the fuckers, really. And you start to get acquitted of the old video.
Listen, please, hold it. That and the fucking Lion shit, my favourite fucking stories, like that. Listen to this for a clever cunt.
Okay. Well, I'd just brought in to the west coast of Scotland 15 tons of Colombian.
That's 15,000 kilos.
Yeah, that's
a lot.
At that time, it was the largest importation into Europe.
I mean,
going off on a bit of a tangent here, if I might do, but like it was brought in near Holyrock, okay, in Western Scotland. Now Holyrock is meant to be like the bastion, okay, of British defence. Submarines, everything there, the most, you know, kind of sophisticated detection equipment, surveillance equipment, everything was at Holyrock in case the fucking Russians come in. Now, you know.
With the Rizzler.
And like, you know, if 5 hippies, right, can take across the fucking salvage tank with 15 tons of fucking gold, stink into high heaven, you know, within 100 yards of this bastion of British defence. It makes you wonder why those of you who pay taxes do so. So, got this loaded, okay, and you know, very careful, even though we brought it into Western Scotland, we obviously didn't want to sell it locally or anything, and move it all down to it and knock it out to the usual distribution channels. No, it's smart sophistication. Though the money still largely came in Scottish fivers, I never worked that out. Anyway, moved the stuff down to London and started selling it. More and more. And soon, you know, everyone who was selling dope in Britain, okay, was selling the same Colombian weed. Every bus that was made in Britain, whether it was, you know, a little bit of smoke in the pocket or a car load full of dope, was the same Colombian weed. Okay. To make matters worse, one of the
Every bag had your name on it.
No, I was on the run at the time.
We ain't got that bit.
No, I was on the run already when I bought this thing. I was going on the run as well. Don't confuse me, Jesus. Oh, yeah. Every bust, okay, everything they knew about weed that was on the streets of Britain was the same weed. Also, one of the Americans got paranoid and ditched a few tons of the Colombian weed when moving it in a sailboat from one part of Scotland to the other. And lots of those bags washed up on the beach. Right? Fishermen found them. Some of the fishermen recognized what it was. God bless them. They sold it. That was fine. Yeah. The others didn't recognize what it was and handed it in to the cops. So the cops been given 2 tons of fucking weed in Scotland. Every bust from John O'Groats to Land's End would be in the same fucking dope. And see, you must never underestimate, okay, the ability of the police. They figured out there must be a big load of fucking dope that's gone into here. Never underestimate them. Probably through Western Scotland. So, okay, surveillance all big time, big time, big time. And eventually, I was caught in very, very embarrassing circumstances, really. I had, the keys, really, to the place that they just busted, behind which was 5 tons of dope. I had the accounts of the entire operation in my handwriting. I had 30 grand of cash. I was already on the run. Okay, things didn't look good. I skipped bail, there was no chance of getting that, okay. So, and see, like when you're facing those sort of odds, okay, there's only one thing you can do.
Skin up.
What do you want to think you could do, right? And that's lying like fuck. So that's what I did, really. I just, you know, it was the longest possible fucking trial imaginable, about 9 weeks of the old baby, okay? I was about 9 days on the stand and just talked the load of fucking cobbler.
Yeah, but tell him what you think, because this is worth getting your cock out, isn't it?
Fucking hell, we put you up to work.
Well, I told them, you know, that I was actually monitoring this very large drug dealing outfit in Colombia for a liaison force between British Secret Service and Mexico. I've obviously said the British Secret Service would not be allowed to admit I worked for them still. And there's a bit of proof around, like, look at all these newspapers and things like that. And then paid the Mexican law official, law government official, $500,000, okay, to come along and also lie, okay. And all he said, okay, this is what my $500,000 got me, all he said to every question that he was asked was, I'm sorry, but I'm not allowed to answer these questions, okay. That's all he said, that's all he got for $500,000. Now, I got me, so like, for a few hundred quid, they would come along, I got mates would fucking do it for nothing, right? Put a sombrero on their head, go to the old lady. That's right.
Or I'd have done it with a joint.
Everyone knew it was completely impossible for what they were saying to be true. Like, absolutely everyone knew, you know, including, obviously, the jury. They fucking acquitted me. I mean, I often wonder why, you know. And I thought, well, obviously, you know, like, at least 8 of them smoked dope, because you can tell.
They were letting in airbags. Big old dope.
Not going to bang him up with a big dealer. So I don't know. And I think I come across as a nice guy who didn't deserve
half of his life. Class, class, this is Wendy. At the time of that, right, it was very, the British law was this, if there is an element of doubt, You have to find the man not guilty if there's an element of doubt, right? And if you are working for British Secret Service, when you sign the Official Secrets Act, it says if you ever go to court, or if you're ever asked anything, all you're allowed to say is, I refuse to answer that question. So he was coming out absolute bollocks, like, I'm working for the CIA, the fucking MI5, MI6, and fucking GBH, 20 Benson, he's worked for all of them. And then when they got the MI5 boss in and went, is Howard working for you? The geezer went, I can't really say. And when he got the Mexican come in and went, is Howard really liaison for, like, you know, MI6? He went, I can't really tell. So that is an element of doubt, you know what I mean? That is an element, so they had to go not guilty, which I think is fucking horny. I just really
But, you know, it was, you know, it did require a lot of work, you know, because I mean, every time I'd come up with a new story to myself in my head and my cell, you know, there'd be more fucking depositions, more evidence against you. Fucking hell, I'm going to rewrite that fucking, you know.
I'm not joking, I'm all joking aside, and we've all been in there. You know when you're sitting in your cell and you read your decks and you think, and you boom, 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 and then you make up a story yourself, I swear you end up believing yourself. You think, no, I'm fucking not guilty. That's a lot of bollocks.
I think it's important to look at guilt as a technical relationship between charge and evidence. That's a little more the truth.
Now I know the gear has kicked in.
And so, I mean, you know, if you do wriggle out to things like that, you've got to put a hell of a lot of work into it. You can't get somebody to solicit a life without telling them they're so embarrassed. Well, you were defending yourself, didn't you?
Yeah, I'm telling you. We had that story, actually. I think you was having a puff at the time.
No, I
mean,
you were talking about it the first
half, didn't you? Oh, sorry. Yeah, yeah, yeah. My little tip is this. Right, listen, I'm going to give you two little tips if you're intent on being a criminal. One is bring your own witnesses. Right, if I'm going to go and rob that fucking post office, I'll ask you and your wife will give you 500 quid, and you and your wife will give you 500 quid to be in the queue. When I burst in, do my little bit of shit and fuck off, by the time the old bill turn up and go, does anyone see anything? No cunt wants to be a witness apart from your four. That big, tall, ginger, black bloke, mate, left an horse back that way. Millwall check. And if they fucking catch you, the four witnesses go, no, it weren't him. There's a plucky little touch, and there's another little tip for you. Right, normally, if they actually nick you for something and you go, well, no, it weren't me, I weren't there. Normally, if they say, well, your telephone actually puts you within 5 foot of the crime, and your car was on a speeding ticket just two roads away, that normally would be enough to get you guilty and send you away for 10 years, right? So, if you're clever, next time you go to do a little bit of work, send your mate and your car and your phone that way to London, right? Make as many phone calls as he likes, get as many flashing lights as he likes while you're robbing the fucking bank. That way. And if you get caught, right, you can actually go, because it should be enough evidence to actually put you in prison, it should be enough evidence to get you out. If they're saying it was you, something like, hold it. My phone says I was in Brighton. And the fucking traffic warden said I was in Brighton and all, so fuck it. I know you're laughing at that, but remember it.